And I think the human body has in the brain has an extraordinary desire to fix itself, to heal yourself. You think you can do it. You're strong. You're well. I can get better by myself. I'm here to tell you, no, you can't get better by yourself. I tried. I walked all the way around Crete. It didn't work. Took beautiful photographs. I drank lots of ouzo and ate olives, but I didn't get better. I didn't get better at all. It took me a long time to get better, because in order to get better, not to say that I didn't have a lot of treatment. I did. I, of course, thought the grass was greener on the other side, and left my marriage to Pierre, thinking that the life was unbearable as the wife of the Prime Minister, the stress, everything, that it was what was causing me such anxiety and hurt and pain. No, it was my illness that was, but I didn't see that. And so I went on all kinds of adventures to try and find peace of mind. I didn't find it. I didn't. I finally found it when a psychiatrist in New York, who I was having dinner with, bluntly told me that he thought I was quite mentally ill and I should come up to his office and have a consultation. Okay. He put me on lithium, and it was the first time I discovered what other people have in their brains normally, and it's peace of mind, it's consistency, it's quiet, it's silence, it's peace. I was always so energized and busy. I went home, I left New York and Studio 54 and all that fun, and I got a little house and raised my children next to my husband, who was at 24 Sussex. And life was good, but it was the first step of my reaching out and getting help. I thought I had another family. I was blissfully happy. He was nothing like Pierre Trudeau. He never ever thought about anything, I don't think. He just was. And I adored my husband, my second husband. We had two beautiful children, and it never occurred to me that I was sick. I never thought I was sick. It was over. That was just all part of Pierre Trudeau and being Prime Minister's wife. I called 24 Sussex the crown jewel of the federal penitentiary system. So, anyway, no, it wasn't. It was my mind that was the prison I was in. After the birth, unfortunately, of my fifth child, I hate to even say this out loud because I love her more than life, but I didn't even see it. I slipped into another depression, and that was it. My world started unraveling again. Postpartum depression is a really serious, serious illness and must be watched for. Anyway, all to say, it ended with a huge breakdown after I lost my son, as you know, in an avalanche. And 2 years later, I lost Pierre. And the battle with grief and with loss that I tried to do on my own, with the help of a big bag of BC Bud and a bottle of good scotch, anything I could to drown the pain, to get me away from it, to stop it. I got myself so thin, so emaciated, so mad that I went and found out that bipolar is a misnomer. It's not bipolar. There's a third stage. There's a third one, and it's psychosis, and it's where nothing makes any sense anymore. There's no rational collecting of the dots. There's no understanding why we live, why we dress, why we comb our hair. I got into that stage, and that was the beginning of the end for me, because I couldn't live anymore. I was too thin, I was too tired, I had no courage. I was put into a psychiatric hospital, and I had a doctor who said I had a choice. I could either go home and die, or I could take his hand and go through the long, which would be a long process, of changing my mind, of getting healthy, of getting a new outlook on life, of getting back hope, of getting back a sense of self after all I'd been through. 3 years of cognitive behavioral therapy, which was the best, changing the way I thought. Lots and lots and lots of pharmaceuticals, which now I take just a little. But mainly it was finding balance and accepting that I have a problem. One of my doctors likes to call it the bipolar predicament, which doesn't sound bad at all, just a predicament. But it is. It's you have to choose a way to live. And certainly the support that the Brain Injury Association gives to its patients, the people who they're working with, is the most important help after you get the neurological help and the doctor's help. because it gives you the hope and the ability to live, the toolbox to be able to be part of life. And for everyone, the secret is to have purpose, to be involved, to be connected. With mental illness, what happens with depression, with the mania I lived, you're taken out of your life. You're disconnected, you're alienated, you're on the edge. And I'm sure that's the way it is for people who have suffered a brain injury, because they have to find a new way to live, to have relationships, to succeed, a new way to be. And I certainly had to find that from my mental illness. So I am so proud to be here, to tell you the truth, really proud that we in Canada have organizations such as this that will help those who really do need the help and who want it, and it's here in place for them. I wish you there were these organizations all across the country. You're a very good example, John, for what you're doing for the rest of the country, because it's with compassion that you're working and giving us all what we deserve to be the best we can be in spite of whatever is going on in our brains. So thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here. I'm sorry for going blah, blah, blah. Thank you.